Hey, Powers. Hi.
Seven to
42 or so. Those are completely random numbers, but that like family time when you don't have any money and you don't have any time, and how do we reach those people and make an exciting time? So that's something we're trying to do too. And then we're also more rural communities. Here in Minnesota, we're in the metro area. We do make trips, what we call greater or outstate Minnesota. But I would love to, if you have any insight on how to like really effectively reach more rural communities in a larger capacity. So that's what I want. And then I think the rest of this is, feel free to read through it. If we touch on these questions in the session, that's awesome. But just take this with, I have it in a document so I can share it too. But I just want to start, the first section I really actually want to talk about, so things to look for in a partner site that I think are really important for the most effective partnerships. And, how you were talking about the elementary school that we wound up with, right? That happens sometimes, you know, like you have a community and you're like, I want to go here, I want to be in this neighborhood, and the only partner isn't quite the right partner, but it's into that community, that happens. It happens. And I love what, is Daniel here? No, but what Daniel was saying too about like that beautiful community in the men's treatment house, which was a house, so you're performing in the living room, right? For many theaters, that might actually not be an option because of funding. I mean, you have to have X number of people in the room in order to make it possible. But I try my best. Like, if there's a community that I know just would love it, and there's only going to be 20 people, I go anyways. And then what we try to do on the other end is open that up to a few members of the general community to come too, so we can kind of reach our like 40 goal. But the things that you're really looking for in a partner is a dedicated staff. And David was saying that of True North, you know, like you have this dedicated staff and they're great, and then the week before the show they kind of drop off the planet. Totally possible. The thing that I try and remind myself over and over as I'm constantly trying to communicate with a million people is that this programming that we're doing is extra to whatever the rest of their life is, their work life, their personal life, all of that. So I do my best to be the reacher, to not expect people to come to me as much as possible. But in saying that, you really do want to find the most dedicated staff that you can, people that are really going to be your active allies in securing spaces and audiences. Here with 10,000 Things, because we're so small, like I do my best, but I don't, because I'm stage managing the show as well, I can't be as active in making those partnerships super, super personal, because I'm in the rehearsal room versus making phone calls and things like that. So you kind of navigate, and I'm sure some of you have smaller staffs, and you understand that. But, so dedicated staff, number one. And then number two is a built and easily accessible population. And this, it's kind of a no-brainer with correctional facilities, because they're there, the captive audience joke. But some other audiences that seem like they would be really great partners would be like your local public high school. It could actually be a great partner, but a number one for us that we found is that we always try and make sure that the people in our audiences choose to be there. Because you're just going to have a lot more fun, and they're going to get a lot more out of it too. So if you do partner with, like say, a local high school that is just a local public high school versus an alternative center or something like that, really be active in asking them to make the audience like a choice participatory. When it's mandatory, it's difficult for everybody, and especially your actors. We want to take care of them. And then the third thing I look for, which maybe doesn't seem right, but the third thing I look for is the space. So, yeah. It's always great if you can get a lot of people, but if you have got the community and the funds to reach that community in a small space, go for it, try it. It might be one of those excruciating stories that you didn't, but it's worth a try. But that being said, like a gymnasium, and be creative with your thinking about spaces too. So sometimes you walk in and Like, this is a lot of space, but there's a lot of stuff in it. Talk with the staff, see if there's anywhere that stuff can go for 3 hours. Maybe you guys can come in and help move that stuff back and make it all possible. So that's just a super quick
kind of part. Yeah. Can I throw in a fourth one that I've kind of started thinking in my head? Is a sense from the organization of, but a sense of connection between us bringing this play in and how it might advance their organizational mission.
Yeah.
So that, I find that's been really helpful for me in going in these places with a sense of being a guest rather than a sense of, we're bringing you brilliance, but here's how we're connecting to what you guys are already doing. And I find that has been, that's really been helpful in kind of getting that dedicated staff member and somebody who's really excited about being there. You kind of start with this, okay, we want to help you rather than just.
Yeah. I try and shy away from when approaching a community. I've done it in the past, but it always kind of feels a little bit weird. I try not to think of what we do as a gift. I mean, for our free performances, they really are. We're able to have the funding and support to make them free to the communities that we're going to. But it's really an exchange, I think. Mm-hmm. And we talked about it this morning. We get so much from these audiences and these communities. Yes, we're bringing you a show, and yeah, it's pretty expensive, and yes, we hope that you like follow through and bring an audience and stuff, but what we get from you is incredibly valuable too. So thinking about it as a partnership and approaching that in a way that like find that true connection is really great. Yeah. Excellent. So I'm just gonna kind of dive in a little bit with some statistics about 10,000 things, which is really exciting. So this is all we do. We just tour like this. We do 3 performances a year, between 6 and 7 weeks each performance. So that's around somewhere between, depending on weeks, around 98 performances, half of which are free. So that means I have 50 partners that I need to reach every year. Last year, I 38 performance. So there's 50 free shows, and we reached 38 separate partners. So that means there's a couple of facilities that we go to for every show, a couple of correctional facilities, and then a couple of community hubs that we've started. So we go to those all 3 shows a year, and then I would say that about a third of the performances are new partners every time. So that's something I want to talk about too. Finding new partners. Like, finding new partners is something I am continuing to do. I do have a list of about 50 partners that I reach at least every other year. And then another like list of 60 or so potential that I try and tap into as much as possible. And then a whole big old list of people that we've tried and hasn't worked. So it really is a lot about trial and error. But you're looking for those connections that really, really work. So in that, thank you for starting that, David. I'd love to jump back and say, for those of you that have been doing this a while, like how have you found some of your most successful long-term partners?
I'll start.
Yeah.
Since we have, I'm Stephanie, I'm from the public, and the mobile unit has been going for 7 years strong now. And I think over the years, I think this is maybe more, I don't know if this is more applicable to like institutions that don't just do this or not, but a strategy has kind of emerged that has been really helpful in that our partnerships absolutely exist on a hyper-local level, but they also exist on a municipal level, on a state level, and in the case of our federal prisons, on a federal level. So, NYC Parks, which is the municipal branch that sort of oversees all of the outdoor parks and the rec centers, has been our most sort of steadfast partner throughout the 7 years. And what we've been able to do in working at the city level in New York is really show up to NYC Parks and say, how can the public theater in general, but specifically this program, the mobile unit, how can we be of service to you? Where do you need us to go? So whereas we started initially being like, well, the public wants to go to Washington Heights, or the public wants to go to the Bronx, we finally like got it together and said, dear New York, where do you need us to go? And the answer was super surprising. So I have been, this is just like a quick anecdote to illustrate the like sometimes the difference between what we think they need and what they actually need. Mm-hmm. I have been really anxious about going to our Harlem Community Center and opening it up to the public. Like we used to sort of lock down our community performances and our marketing departments. Like, can we tell our audiences we may not? Because they don't want to go colonize Harlem or the Bronx or. And that was my assumption. When I actually talked to the Parks Department, they said, we need you to go to Washington Heights and to Harlem and to the Bronx, and we need you to shine the biggest light possible on these community centers because people don't know they're there. We need you to transform the way the community centers are being used so that people think that it's more than just for basketball. Mm-hmm. And we need to increase foot traffic inside of those community centers. And we're we immediately, like, I let them, you know, the marketing department to do their best work. And that was a hugely transformative moment inside of the partnership with the Parks Department. And so now we go over and over and over to the same park sites and are building audiences, twice and sometimes three times a year. But that kind of like strata, but working at different stratas inside of the city with the Parks Department and the center manager to say, wait, what is the best time and what audience do you want to reach, has been the magic combination. So we're sort of taking that model and applying it to the library systems within New York City and the public housing systems within New York City. So just very broadly speaking, that is a strategy that's worked really well.
Have you had performances in the libraries?
Mm-hmm.
So far? And have they been successful?
Awesome. Yeah. And you want to talk a little bit about
Queens?
Because we do two library performances. For the first is in it's in Manhattan at the Lincoln Center Performing Arts Library in a very like closed sort of like cafe moment.
After hours. Yeah. So we there's three branches of the library in New York City. Depending on the borough. So Queens has its own system, Brooklyn has its own system, and Manhattan has the same system as the Bronx and Staten Island. So we had gone to Manhattan, the Performing Arts Library, in a very closed room after hours. They had the infrastructure to run their own RSVP list on an Eventbrite RSVP, and we had been going for a couple years. So we got into Queens, and we were talking to their programming people, and they were like, oh, you have to go to the Central Branch. We have to go to the Central Branch in Jamaica. We've never had theater there. We've only had music in the atrium. It's like, okay, the atrium, middle of the day, that's going to be different for us. And I made the mistake of not doing the site visit at the time we would perform, because during the day there isn't any programming in the libraries. The foot traffic is very low. If there's a school group, they're going to a different part. It was very quiet. It seemed what I thought. Perfect to start, always knowing there are things that I don't know. And so we got there, this was like 2 weeks ago, it seems like a lifetime ago, at around 6 p.m., that's when they really wanted us to start. That's when their programming starts. They only have a certain amount of hours before they have to kick in overtime. So we had to be out of the room by like, I think 9 o'clock, something like that. So we had to start at 6. Then we got there, and this place was completely full of life, and it almost felt as if we were displacing stuff that was going on. Mm-hmm. We had checkers in the corner, we had new stuff happening. There was so much traffic in this central place, which for them was like, duh, great, we're gonna get an audience. And for us, it was like, is this the right time for us to actually be in this? And we're still asking that question. It was successful. The audiences were great. It was great for them to go to their local library and see the Winter's Tale. But it was just a very interesting moment of like, yes, success in so many ways, but there are also questions we need to keep asking them of, is there potential to perform after hours, what would that do? And just kind of continuing to ask the questions of, all right, what are we going to change for next time?
That brings up a really good, on your little sheet, you'll see later if we look at it. One of the things that to look for is the assembled audience, right? It's always easiest to come in and do the show when there's already a built-in audience, but also asking yourself, what am I displacing by being here? Because sometimes that can be a really important thing. So in a lot of our facilities, we can be like, oh, there's AA groups or NA groups, come do the performance for them. Yes, and that's a really therapeutic time for those people, and they are going to those meetings because they need to talk to another in a private setting, and they need that time together. That's why they're there. That's why they're choosing to be there. So that's always been like a, this is a great idea, but I don't know if it's actually ever been successful to bring those people in there, because that's their time that they need, and they're not there to see theater. They're there to talk about what they need to talk about. So it's a really great thing to ask yourself and think about, because at the same time, if you go and you do a show in the middle of the day and it's dead, then you don't have an audience. So having the partner that will work with you and figure out what the best time is awesome. And we have not done the, with public housing and various nonprofits, we've looked at things that way, and like different Common Bond is a public housing nonprofit in Twin Cities, and so we've connected with them at various sites, but I love the idea of going to recreation centers and figuring out what that is. That's an awesome idea. Great. Does anybody else have anything to share about some successful partnerships that they've had?
But you were talking about accessing rural, redder parts of the area in northern Indiana. And so we're in a bit of a Democratic bastion in South Bend, but the outline is very conservative. Mm-hmm. And what we found when we're touring is when you're first visiting a community, because then, we don't have a centralized municipal government that we're working with. We have to, like, all these towns and villages, so it gets more and more complicated. Is find usually an art series in the summertime. And for that first visit to that community, get yourself in between like this country rock concert and this high school play or something, this high school musical they do, but on that stage that audience feels safe coming to. Develop the relationship then, because you have come to their front door and you've entered their space. Then start developing those relationships with the rec centers, the community centers, those people in that community. So they feel like, oh, that Notre Dame thing is coming back to town. I'll go to that weird theater place that I don't normally go to, or that weird community center, or whatever. They just feel, it takes away the intimidation factor.
I was gonna say, when I first started working on our tour, one of the things that I did was to go around to a lot of different communities that have, they have like monthly meetings with service providers from different social services and resources. And I started off then just doing some listening in those areas. And it took me to pretty much every corner of San Diego you could imagine. And then over time relationships, you started seeing the same people in different parts of town. And then they started getting curious about why I was even there. So then that helped open up the door. But being there and being present as often and as regularly as I could, whether I was there to talk about a show or opportunity, or just listening to hear what's really going on in that community. This year with our tour, one of the things that we did, because of San Diego, the arts funding was on the chopping block big time this past spring. And so we already had sort of a general idea, like, we might not be everywhere in San Diego, And now we're kind of like, okay, we really need to be everywhere in San Diego, because when this conversation comes back up, it's going to come back up again in the next year. We need to really find ourselves in every district in some way, shape, or form. So it's actually a little bit of a layer of pressure, but it's also made it a little bit easier for me to focus in now on where to be and who to go to. To really find the pockets that are really needed in a specific area of town, so that when we're sitting down with those council people, explaining to them why they should be supporting us, we have something to say. We're here, we're with this partner and that partner. Some of my sites are multiple partners, so I kind of distinguish now between the partner who is the venue, who's housing the show, but then I may have two or three other partners who are also bringing people in to come and see that show. So it's not just, it's no longer just a partner and us, who's our host, you know, for the location and the community, but they are now also opening up their doors to a larger community. And then we're talking about the library system, city and county for us has become really fantastic partners. And we do other programs in addition to our tour, and so that's really enabled us to, A, they have a built-in mechanism marketing-wise, so you don't have to do as much. Sometimes, however, what I find is that there's a lot of overlap between our regular audience and libraries, so sometimes that's why those other partners are still important, so that I'm still bringing in other people who may or may not have heard about it, or who don't regularly go to the library or whatever. So it really is a little bit of a multi-layered approach in many ways, depending on where you're going. And rec centers, we tried it for rec centers last year, and I was like, until we get into the level that you guys are, where we're actually at a strategic point with the rec centers in the city of San Diego, you know, I'm dealing with the guy whose job it is, and he doesn't really care. So it brings it back to finding dedicated staff and people who we have, and think that this is something that really matters.
We had Delaware Shakespeare's second year of our tour. This was this year. One of our partners was a Ministry of Caring, which has multiple operations around the city in different types of situations. It helps that one of the directors is the husband of our board president, that they very much bought into and what we were doing. So when we went to do the show at the senior center that they operate, the Welcome Senior Center, they were also able to bring in some people from the men's shelter that they operate separately. And an AIDS clinic that they operate separately came in. And we just happened to bring a group from our children's arts center, have them want to come to a show, it was the closest one. So, in a moment that lives in infamy, infamy is the wrong word, the opposite of infamy, in a moment that lives in the great memory of our actors, when our Jack Weiss got up to do the Seven Ages of Man speech, she realized the Seven Ages of Man were present in the room. And so for each bit, she went out to some of the audience and brought them up. A child, a young boy, all the way up to the end, and was able to illustrate this speech in a way the actors should still talk about. They will never see that speech done in that way again. I think what it really solidified to us, besides having great partners there, was exactly what you were saying. Suddenly we're interested, what if we help curate some of these experiences a little bit by engaging multiple space, which we hadn't done before. We've been going to one, and that fits its own interesting bits how the performance is different. But are there opportunities to bring the community together, even within those communities, more to all experience the play? And is it richer if there's a diversity of experience in the room? So that's on our thinking caps for next year. You have your venue partner, and is that venue partner open and is it easily accessible for some people from other parts of the community?
For both of you, I'd love to hear more about the non-venue partner.
Yeah.
And like, who were they?
Kind of related back to my can't tell the story at the elementary school. What I learned for doing a show at elementary school was we had done it before, and the partnership was with a community service organization who was part of a federally funded program around a group of schools. So we had gone to this other school and partnered with the middle school and the elementary school the first year, but it was being really organized by the service provider organization. So that recipe really worked well. This year they've expanded to some of the other schools to fill the audience, to give more people that are part of this program access to see our show instead of it being just the audience just being from the one school. Went to Camp Pendleton, and I didn't have that. It was just us trying to find a venue on Camp Pendleton. That didn't work, right? So we have not gone back there until we figure out what that relationship can look like, because it will have to be probably several partnerships from different facets of the military that's there. The recipe that has worked with multiple partners has been, in Lemon Grove, we go to a Lemon Grove Academy, which happens to be sitting right next door to the Lemon Grove County Library. And then we have a really great influencer and advocacy through the Lemon Grove Historical Society. So that's our, you know, the great triumvirate of for that program is because, so I'm kind of getting the older, retired, you know, generally white person from the historical society, but who's really heavily invested in seeing the youth in that community, which is very, very diverse, and their families get plugged in. And then with the backbone of having the library, which now is also an additional mechanism to help advertise and get the word out to the larger community. So it's those three things are a really happy marriage for that site. Now, I will also say that this year we had like an amazing turnout at this location, but that was because, in part because I found out later that one of the teachers at the school decided to offer extra credit, you know. So all of a sudden, my numbers, I was like, this is the first time we've been here, I've never seen this many people show up, you know, rumor later on, oh, okay, they got extra credit. So, you know, so now I go back to the partner and be like, maybe don't do that. You know, like, let's really work on creating an authentic, you know, experience and relationship with the kids and their parents so that they're coming together as a family and I'm not getting, you know, half of seventh grade as part of my audience. But in either direction, you know, the mayor of Lemon Grove is highly interested now in watching what we're doing. You know, so there's a lot of other layers that have really happened because we went into that community working with more than one partner. So we're getting much wider attention, people are interested in different ways, and have, you know, now are just really excited. So it's a good thing, like the kids come in and are like, what did you order for food for us this time? We do meals in advance sometimes, and so, you know, like, well, you know, this time is better than last time, you have better drinks this time. I mean, like, they will tell you. So it's been really cool to see that those partnerships are really working out.
I just wanted to offer a little perspective from a very, very small organization. Our organization was founded by five people who are all actors by training and by trade, and we've built this together, and we're administrators and artists, and always, and thus far have been administrators and artists at the same time during shows. So shows that I've performed in, I've also been our venue scout and coordinator and organized and scheduled the tour, which is a really tremendous challenge, but also a really tremendous way to build partnerships. Because I also have tried really hard to make sure I go to community meetings, if there's a client meeting at a shelter, if there's a residence meeting at a senior living facility where we often perform, to show up, introduce myself, and welcome them both as someone who's organizing and an artist who don't meet on the day. We really try to think of our, as I think everyone in this room does, our performances as both community events and artistic events and opportunities for as much human connection as possible. So the before and after is so important when we're speaking to the audience and speaking to the people who work there. So when you've come in advance and had FaceTime, there's someone that was at the residence meeting who you can say, oh, Sylvia, we met and this was so tremendous. And a lot of those have been our most successful partnerships. And to bring any additional artists who are available, other cast members who could come as well, that makes a strong impression on the staff too, and then communication gets much better, and suddenly we're like the circle is moving in a really, really fluid way.
Yeah.
And we've also found that because we are a smaller organization, there are certain venues that aren't working for us as well, right? Our community centers are really challenging. It's hard for us to impress upon them, the staff, in a way that we would like to, that we really need an audience to come. And we've also tried to work really strategically when we're at shelters or senior assisted living facilities around things like meal times, when we know a larger percentage of the population will be gathered. That provides certain challenges as well. Meal times have pushed back start times for us a lot, and we want to be respectful, so tremendously respectful of the people who are just trying to have their dinner and you're now standing in their space waiting to do a show. So that's something we're still navigating, but those partnerships have really, really helped us.
Yeah, I think that's an important thing to note too, at another level. So I've been with the company for 11 years, and when I first started, the managing director, well, when at way back, Michelle did everything, and then the managing director booked the show, booked the tours, and then I stuck around. So they're like, hey, you can book the tours, because I was going on the tours, so it made sense for me, because I was the person, I was their go-to, because they saw me every time, to go and book the tours and maintain these relationships. But then it becomes difficult when I'm that main connection, but I'm also trying to run the show. So so there's some like staff shifting and figuring that out. So as you're starting, it's a lot, you know, be prepared. So in thinking about that too, I would suggest, Danielle up from Baltimore Center Stage. It's a slightly bigger institution, but it's still just kind of him. He started his touring with 10 venues, which is a lot. Like, I would really encourage to kind of focus in and think a little bit smaller, get some footing under you so you can have some, like, successes and feel really good. And then it's worth all the work. But it can be tricky as far as time. And how many did you
have? Well, as I said, the first year we did, we started with 12 indies.
Yeah,
I remember calling Michelle. I was like, yeah, we're doing 12 indies and then 2 weeks to look forward to it. And Michelle goes, you would have my blessing if you did less.
Yeah.
And it was a lot, but for us, it was strategic. And, you know, this is probably open to how do you fund all this thing?
Uh-huh.
We felt we needed to kind of make a big initial splash with the wrong word, but to say, like, hey, we're doing this.
Mm-hmm.
We felt like we couldn't really do that with just saying, we're doing 4 shows. And we felt like we needed to be a bigger presence to be able to say, we're doing this, funders come help us kind of thing. But
yeah.
It was certainly, it was a lot.
I think also gives you a chance to have great exhilarating moments.
Oh, yeah.
And if you do 3 of these, you might end up with 3 excruciating.
Oh, totally.
and that could be.
Quick question. I was wondering if anybody, and I'm green, so I'm learning, you know, still learning. Hopefully learning from all of you. I'm wondering if somebody could speak on making sure that partnership is mutually beneficial to both parties. I can't remember who over here said, you know, how does the work help advance the mission of, you know, the entity that you're partnering with, or I can't remember who said that. I'm thinking specifically as it relates to funding. We all know that productions are expensive, and, you know, we're fortunate if we have the funding to begin with just to do the work. I have talked to folks on my board, and they're like, oh, you should partner with this entity because they just got this big grant, and they have money. But, you know, to me, that really feels that feels superficial and wrong on so many different levels. But at the same time, we do need the support in order to even engage in our partnership. So I'm just challenged trying to figure out how in the world do we make sure that this partnership is mutually beneficial in a really sincere and authentic way.
Well, when we were first trying to figure out who we were going to perform for, I started about a year ahead of time, I would just go around and meet with people and you know, kind of give the 5-minute version of, you know, what this would be and what it would be like. And my first question to every person I went to is, does this sound interesting to you? and kind of why? You know, what would kind of, how would this be useful to you? And that was tremendously just great information for me to get, so that we could also then share that with our artists and our actors getting ready to do this. Yeah, because each, what we found is that different people wanted us to come in for different reasons, which was fascinating. The psychiatric center really just wanted to say because it was a way for their patients to have human engagement. You know, whereas the prison reentry program wanted us there because a lot of their men had never been able to take their family to a play before. So it was just really helpful to kind of learn, oh wow, there's so many different points of why people want this.
Some of the money followed. Just to say that I don't think we've ever gone to a place because we knew that they could pay us. But some who have money like it so much they pay us. So, sometimes if you know, some of this was very intentional with the state psychiatric center, they were able to give us a grant that worked out. So one library we went to this year just gave us a $500 check on the way out, and the friends of the library said, our, you know, friends were so happy to have you here and wanting to give you some money. So, some of it's just been sort of that should happen afterwards, but it hasn't been as substantial.
But the partnership does not happen because of the money. Following the, as a possible result of the
evening. Hi, I'm Amelia from BCG. One thing that we give away other people's money, which is fabulous, these types of projects. One thing that's worked for a lot of organizations is to create a memorandum of understanding. And it doesn't have to be, you know, when you hear that, it sounds like, oh, it's going to be legalese and it's going to be a contract. It could be just a very simple mutual agreement, because the thing that's going to make it work this kind of work or any kind of audience engagement, community development work is equitable partnerships. And there are very obvious power dynamics that are going on when you're talking about a smaller organization and a larger organization. So it's going to be different for every purpose and different for every set of partners, but to have really clearly walking me in what this looks like and having to talk offline about any of that.
Just jumping in on, just in terms of looking at partners, you know, and figuring out if it's mutually beneficial. When we first started, and I wasn't there the first year, so I'm telling somebody else's story, but basically our producer, Eric Queen Louie, went on the internet and started like looking up things like, hey, we're going to do this tour, you know? And he found the senior center in an African, predominantly African-American neighborhood who did line dancing. And he was like, hey, those people look like, I mean, it was kind of that simple. It was like, they look like they might be interested in something like this. And then he takes up the phone, and he had a conversation. And now, you know, every year before the show starts, those ladies line dance. And this year, they pulled in the production team who was prepping for the show and the cast, and anybody who would, you know, was willing, and the square was filled with a beautiful blend of our community and their community, and seeing us all sort of sort of a family of people, and it's just a thing we do now. But, you know, I think that's sort of the thing, is I look at what else do they do? What is their mission? Like, literally just reading their website and then having that conversation. Going to the library, what kind of programs are they, you know, having? When we went to the Otay Mesa Library this year, and we showed up for the show, the library had gone and done a big display of all of their Shakespeare books and plays, and like, you know, and there was a dry erase board, and someone had taken our poster and redrawn it on the whiteboard, bigger. So eventually, I mean, I think it's just, you start to figure out what really matters, but just looking at what they're doing, you know, and asking who's coming. That's what I always ask.
And it can be hard too. So what we are dealing with right now is a long-time partner, longer than I've been with the company, Hennepin County Corrections. We haven't been able to get in there for a year because somebody somewhere down the line of hierarchy decided that only programming that directly prevents recidivism will be done. Boop, that's it. So I have not been. So I've been like, okay, so we'll go in through education. Try that venue, but then they can only get us 12 guys at a time, and we have to do workshops and the show, so then that's only 6 guys, you know, so we're really trying to figure out how it is, so in that case, we're trying to figure out how we can improve, which we don't. I mean, we do in a lot of ways, we build empathy, we tell stories, we do that, but how does company doing a show reduce recidivism? Know, but we do know that we benefit that community. So trying to figure out how to do that. There's a lot of like Shakespeare in the Prison things, but if we don't, if we're not doing the workshops, it's hard for us to prove that point.
We have data for you.
Really?
Yeah.
Let's do it.
Yeah.
Oh, Stephanie, and then.
We have I've been with 10,000 Things for 2 years, so I'm really learning a lot as I move forward with the organization. One of the things that I'm really interested in seeing and understanding more about are some of the intangible connections that happen with our partners. And they're not so intangible, but we just don't talk about them as much. We talk a lot about the cross-pollination between our audiences and our artists, which is fantastic and really wonderful. But there's also this really great cross-pollination that happens with our patrons and our donors and our partners. So as Nancy said, in some of our partners that we perform for, we may allow 10 seats in our conception of the amount of space that there is in the room for patrons or donors to be able to come and see that performance at a rehabilitation center or at a prison, or so on. Nancy can speak more to, and Amy can speak more to, what that algorithm is to make sure that the balance of the room doesn't tip into being another show for a wealthy audience. However, I'm really interested when I hear our patrons and donors and our artists talk with a really nuanced perspective about these partner organizations over time. And I'm interested to find out more about how often and if and when it happens that our donors become donors to our partner organizations, or our patrons become vested in those partner organizations, because over time they become interested and start to really care about those organizations as well as the artwork that's happening there.
Yeah, and another thing that you can speak more to, but we have various levels of giving, right? So our dragon circles is 1,000, maybe 1,000. So then what we offer then is, so your donation is sponsoring the show, so they can pick the community that I already have on calendar, that they want to make sure is brought, so that they feel more connected to the community too, and that's another way that fun performances. But that's a different session.
One question about the green thing, I'll tell kind of how I was able to kind of solve the dilemma that we faced, was that initially when we were first starting to produce shows, we kept running into this wall of, like, the exchange was, you can use our space, but it's going to cost you $300 an hour, you know, instead of, like, well, you've got a community, can we bring a show to your community? It was like, well, yeah, but it's going to cost you $300 an hour. Like, well, problem is, we can come in, you have no need to get your community here because you've got a check from us, you know, and then, you know, we come and we may not make that money back, you know, because now we have to sell tickets to probably our friends, you know. And that had become an issue that was kind of hurting us, until the way we found around it was, at least in Pittsburgh, every neighborhood has its own citizens council. And so I just started reaching out to these citizens councils, and I kind of narrowed my focus to, like, a specific part of town, and said, you know, we want to bring a show to you. You know, what's your calendar look like? You know, how was this something you're interested in? And suddenly we got the interest, and the community started getting excited to see us. And, you know, and so this year was our second year coming back to the community. And so they're like, oh, you were here last year, and this is great, so I'm bringing my friends. And, you know, so that's been this really valuable partnership, because then I can go to these community meetings and say, hey, next week we're going to be doing the Tempest in the park, so come down and see us. And actually doing, you know, kind of getting outside of the idea of the tour, but, like, staying in that community for the duration of the run, rehearsing in that community, we saw, you know, the numbers got better from one year to the next, and, you know, we're going to be doing our Christmas show in the same community, so we'll see if that's, you know, moving it into a venue, like, how that's going to work. But that was great. But I would love to hear, you know, how people kind of get over this, you know, what we call in our company, four-walling it, is, you know, you kind of rent the space and, you know, you kind of do your best with it. So if anybody has insight on that, I'd love to hear.
I mean, I hit the same problem, and at times I just hate it. Not because I want to, but because I know it's important for me to be there in my case.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I've had to actually just say, okay, but then also going back to the idea of having a partnering organization.
Yeah.
I had another organization who was then going to help me get the bodies there. They just didn't have the actual space, you know, to do it. So so that and then that's what pushed me into saying, okay, let's just pay it.
Yeah.
And then let's work with them to see, you know, how we can feed down or whatever. So, but I'm not going to go back there. Because I did find out the way to get around it is that I have to go to the city council and go and talk about it and get them to vote, you know, against, you know, to nullify, to waive the fees. But that was going to be a really big process, and I didn't have the time at that point to go through the process. So, yeah. That's why I saw
that. Do these organizations, like, think you were there for a money-making purpose? I guess that
we've never faced it.
Like, because we've always started by, like, hey, the whole purpose of this program is to take theater that don't normally have it.
Yeah.
We'd like to share this. It's totally free for you.
Yeah.
So we've actually never had anybody ever go,
and we're going to charge you.
Pay $300 for a space. So I'm just kind of curious.
Really, it kind of began, like, in the search phase, like, where can we go? And, you know, an initial thought was like, there's all these old like Catholic churches in Pittsburgh, and they have these schools connected, and all these schools are closing now. And I'm like, well, you've got an empty building. You know, wouldn't you like to have something in here? And then there was this whole process of like, well, if you want to do this, it's going to cost you this much. And, you know, so we did have some success, but then a whole other issue of like just working with religious organizations and coming into conflict with our mission and, you know, that we had to kind of move away from. But yeah, that was a lot of the, you know, a lot of our initial searches going, okay, let's see if this this community organization, this community center wants to, you know, post something like this, partner with us, and you get on the website, and there's a whole application, and, you know, and then you pay the fee. And it's like, ah. So, like, it just becomes this kind of defeating thing where it's like you have a few instances where you're doing that, and then when you're finding that's the wall you're hitting, you just kind of go, okay, not here.
Yeah,
okay.
And to piggyback a little bit, I'm curious. So we've run into that as well, how we've kind of worked around it is, so let's say there's a community that I really work with that could really benefit from a particular show, but they don't have the space. So then I ask that partner, okay, who, where in your neighborhood would this community feel comfortable, a number one, comfortable going to? Where would they feel welcome? And then so going with that partner to approach that space. So the space knows that we're not there just to bring in any Joe Schmo. Like, we are specifically wanting to work with your community, and we have a population here, and getting the space for free is kind of the only way it's going to make it happen. But we'd love to highlight your organization as well, get your board members to see how it can be mutually beneficial that way as well. Every once in a while, we still like have to split the rent or something like that, but usually not running for $100. And we haven't run into that for a while, but that's kind of my circumventing, is to find the population, and if they don't have the space, to work with them to find the space.
Just to take that a step further, like going back to what you've got here, your first reset, just really finding the advocate in the community, and not the venue first. First, I find a partner. So, and yeah, sometimes I'm thinking about the space with the venue, but usually I will find that the space through partner. And so the relationship, to me, is way more important than just finding the space. So.
Jim, did you?
I just relate to what saying, I'm green and really in the very beginning stages, and I'm even looking for organizations and platform to start. You know. But I relate to the every space that I'm coming from a very small town, conservative town in California, actually, and I'm really trying to develop as a base there theater, because it doesn't really exist, you know. And my biggest issue is getting anyone interested in just letting me use the space for the community. They all want to charge me like I'm from Broadway. You know?
Yeah.
And so I just relate to that as a big obstacle, especially because I have very few advocates right now, so I'm creating these connections. But I find it also, because I've been going to surrounding rural communities on my own accord, just because I'm trying to figure out this puzzle in these more rural places. Space usage, they just charge crazy amounts of money, and they really don't understand that idea of doing this for your community.
And rehearsal space.
Rehearsal
space. Challenge.
Yeah.
I've used my dad's waiting room in his dental office.
Yeah.
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 Yeah, I mean, 16th Street is, I'm also green, it's very new to this kind of work, but what we've been finding is that the more clear the why is for the partnership, the more these problems just sort of organically melt away. Like, I just kind of wait for them to disappear. So, like, we this year we did 9 performances in non-traditional spaces, and it was a little ambitious because each one was a different play. Doing that again, you guys. But the partnerships, because we did that, the partnerships were able to be really specific and thematically, like, it was, we want to tell this story, and who do we think is going to really want this story, and we were really able to, like, find partners who were excited about this project at this moment and this story that we're telling. And then sometimes they would say, and we usually charge this amount for space, and we'd say, yeah, we don't have a budget for that, and then they would say, okay. And the problem would just go away. And that doesn't always happen, but I think when the why for the partnership is just really, really strong and clear, and that's where it starts from. It starts from, so we have this play, and we think that this story is really important for this moment. What do you think about it? And then we'll say, well, yeah, that's something. If the conversation starts from the play, then sometimes the other obstacles just, they're just not there anymore.
I have a question for, I've been sitting here thinking about what it means to, you know, make it to be a good partner, and the way that my mind immediately turns into that sort of reciprocity of like the exchange, but it's still, whether it's tactically or sort of strategically, it still feels like, I don't know, operational in nature. Even when they're, and I guess I'm thinking about the idea of we have a play, like we have chosen a play, and I'll say the public, in the fact that we've only done Shakespeare, I repeatedly hear our communities ask for more than Shakespeare, and I'm not talking about like the old white, you know, this is the part where we continually fail, I think, in not being receptive to, or not even asking the question of what stories might you want to hear. And I'm curious if anybody in this circle has had experience with actually not starting with the play.
Yeah, starting with the community and seeing what they want.
Well, yeah.
We kind of do that in that we do all new work. So all of the new work that we choose comes out of what our tentacles in the community are telling us we need to do. So while we're not actually, I mean, there are people who take this to the extreme where there's like a polling process, and they actually like really get the community to like tell you specifically which play they want, and that's really cool. We haven't gone there yet, but we definitely, like, the programmatic choices that we're making are coming directly from the community, and then we're coming back to the community with an array of things that feel relevant because they came from there secretly.
Yeah.
And just piggybacking off of that, I've done similar work where you're starting from asking what do you need, and the answer to what do you need is not always a play, which is really, I think, critical to this, and just to think about it from like maybe a theoretical framework that's useful, is that one thing that I heard that's really helpful for the question that you just asked was Michael Rowe talking about breaking things down into three specific things, like studio practice, social practice, and civic practice. Mm-hmm. And civic practice being that question, starting out with just asking the partner what you need. Social practice being a lot of what I think is talked about here, which is the artists are in a studio working on what they're working on, and then they're trying to bring it out to a specific community group for a specific shared mutual purpose. And the studio practice obviously being redeveloped in the studio and presented in a traditional art setting. And I think that for the civic practice question point that you're of the what do you need, thinking about how to answer that question very like organically and in a way that might be mundane. You actually see yourself starting maybe sometimes from municipal points is really useful for that. Like I know a story that in the organization I'm involved with, the city of Baltimore, this is in the 70s, you know, the theater came to, which is the theater project, Baltimore Theater Project, I haven't heard it, came to the city of Baltimore and said, okay, great, you know, we're going to do a theater partnership. What do you need? And they were thinking, you know, big themes of, you know, culture and power and violence, these big questions. And the city of Baltimore came back and they said, we have a big problem with rats.
Wow.
Can you do something about that? And he actually developed this thing where they said, okay, and he started by listening and saying, what is this problem with rats and what could help? Right? Not with, we'll do a play about rats, which is eventually actually what ended up happening, but he started out with, well, what do you need? Okay, well, the problem is with the rats in Baltimore City is that sanitation procedures, people are not taking out their trash correctly. That's the problem. How can you solve that with art? Right? And then the question was, well, who takes out the trash? Who's our audience? that's the actual audience, right? Because that's the problem you're trying to solve. They figured out the kind of chore, and that actually from the data, right? The kind of people who take out the trash were often middle schoolers. That was a chore that was appropriate to that level, right? No, seriously. And there's smart people in civic and urban and regional planning who are the people who have that kind of data, who actually know the type of people who take out the trash in middle school. So from there, he thought about, he was like, okay. He developed this fun play that was like this crazy thing called the Rat Squad, where it was like these detectives solving an adventure, and they took it to middle schools in a tour, and they ended up ending out with the students taking the rat pledge about how they would, you know, change their thing. But it wasn't starting with that question of how can we bring some interesting, great play about what we think about Baltimore to you. It was like, just what do you need? How do you start with the problem? And is there an arts-based application that could help you solve that problem? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So the question, has the rat problem gotten
so bad? Well, this was a long time.
Okay.
So this is like the legs in 1978.
Okay.
They did actually find that it made an impact, because they did, again, go back to those urban and regional planners to be able to continually measure that out. Mm-hmm. So it did. I don't think rats are as much of a city problem in most cities anymore. I don't know, as it was back then. Like, I think that, but I think that there's lots of technologies besides arts.
Not specifically with our tour, but I'm on the same page with you in terms of that thinking of other programs that we have. We started about a year ago a community collaborative art making program, essentially. And it came out of really that question, because I really wanted to take the tour to the specific area that it's able for Latin Heights, which is a very, very diverse piece of the Latinx population, but then also a lot of refugees. And I knew this was an area of San Diego that was just not leading your community at all. It's also an area that there's a lot of, you know, heavy philanthropy happening in, people trying to really help address the needs of the community. And I did not want to go in there waving my white flag of fear. And so instead, I heard about their annual Day of the Dead Festival. And I went in and was like, hey, can we be part of this? And here's what I was thinking we could do, if you guys would be interested in it, but we'd love to like create something for your event with you. So I'm gonna bring the tools, but you guys are gonna provide the story and people, and we provide professional artists to actually do the work once it was created. And so we did that for the first time, and it went off, it was pretty good. Five individual little pieces that were performed as part of their festival in their community. And then we went back this year, again, the second year, showed up at the planning meeting, and they said, hey, great, do you guys want to do this again? So the first year was me going, yeah, that's a great idea, you don't know me. But the second year, they wanted us to come back, and then they said, and here's what we'd like to do this time. So that was what was different. So this time, Amanda brought in a director advisor to come in, and we held workshops with the community, and the community told shared stories, talked about the things they wanted to talk about, and then he helped frame it, you know, in a presentation that is now, this year was a 25-minute play that was part of the Day of the Dead Festival. You know, and I also was saying that I brought in a director who was Latino. You know, like, I'm not coming in to do this, right? Like, I brought somebody in who has a frame of reference for mine to really connect. You know, he was a native, you know, speaker and a Spanish speaker. He had created other work before, you know, that was not similar exactly, but that was the thinking. So I had to get out of my box a little bit and really go to the community and be like, what's interesting to you, and do I have the tools to do that? And so instead of just coming in with, I've got a play, or we want to create a play, you know, based on what you told us, but I invited them into the process to create the play. So we had people from that community who performed in it. So it wasn't just, it was anchored by professional, you know, actors, but it wasn't just you know, us coming in and saying we're going to bring a show to you. Now, do have those people yet to show up to my tour? No. But do I care? No.
And they might.
And they might someday, because we have a relationship, and now they are interested. You know, the other thing I did is I invited them to come to us, to our institution, and show us how to put together a traditional Day of the Dead altar, because you have to have one as part of the festival. And so, you know what I mean? Like, starting to create the reciprocity there. What matters to you? What matters to them is that all the people, the providers that showed up at that festival, had a traditional altar. They didn't want people coming up with, you know, weird random things. They wanted people to know and understand and respect what the festival was about. And so that was the kind of reciprocity that you try to create over time.
To make a really quick point, one thing I try not to do when talking to people outside of these funders or else is, so what you're hitting on, is said this is audience development. Because I don't think the point of this is to create the next generation of people who are going to be coming into our theaters. The point of this is to create art that goes everywhere into the communities. The end point is what we're doing. It's not a means to an end to a future funding stream. You know, this, in the moment, is the reason.
It could be a great byproduct that people are exposed to art and maybe want to do that. This professional, and that's an important thing that I've learned that in my privilege I've been having to wake up to lately is we are not, like, a lot of these places aren't devoid of all art. They just might not have theater. So respecting the fact that every community we're going into has art, it just might not look like our art. So I love that you ask them to come and share what they have, because then it's a beautiful, beneficial.
And there's a difference between, you know, I'm going to call it theater with a capital T and theater with a lowercase t.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody does and creates theater or art in some way, shape, or form. It's just not what we have traditionally practiced in our field. So going in and thinking that you're going to be coming and rocking the world is absolutely wrong. They're going to teach you things. They're going to show you things and change the way you think about theater. And it's the same thing that we find with the tour, you know, that we're changed, we're evolved just as much as we hope to help evolve other people. And so always going into that mindset, you're not rocking the world, but you're adding to it, though.
So we don't have very much time. So I just want to spend,
I just wanted to add, as some arts producer who's brand spanking new to this methodology, for myself and the theater that I'm here with, People's Light in Pennsylvania, a value that we have that would serve us well in this work is the priority for long-term relationship and not entering into anything thinking we're just, you know, finding you as this one-time partner, you know, that it's really staying the course and anything we carve out for ourselves, making sure we are able to continue this on for years, and you're in it for the long haul, and I think that will open the doors for your venue. Once, if you find yourself in the room with others who you're trying to convince, we want to use your space, and they're like, pay me, then eventually, just by being around and doing the work, that will speak for itself, and then those partners will come out to woodwork. And also, as you had mentioned, some under-resourced communities who have, you know, foundations looking at them and trying to help in all these different ways, where it can be a lot of cooks in the kitchen trying to help the community or whatever, that by you committing to being there for the long term and the long haul makes such a difference when you're genuine in that invitation and when you're genuine in listening to find out what are the needs and opportunities and who are the partners doing the work already that you can be enhancing and supporting rather than just saying, here to save the day, which you're absolutely not doing. So I'm really excited to kind of put to use some of our wheelhouse in this new way. So
that's a really beautiful segue to a little bit of the opposite. But a beautiful thing to recap. So far we've been talking about what makes a successful partnership, but sometimes partnerships are not successful. And I think it's actually beneficial to talk about what haven't been successful and then how to end that relationship, right? So the goal is always that this will continue, we'll keep coming back, we will maintain this, we will evolve this, we'll keep going. But what happens when it's not super successful? And I'll start. So two examples for us. At a men's shelter, and we showed up, and Michelle was there, and myself as the stage manager. They didn't want to let me in. They knew Michelle, but they didn't want to let me in because I'm a woman. This was an all male version of Richard III. They didn't want to let me in, and then like this little high school group, because we had 10 folks from the outside came, and there was a couple of girls. They didn't want to let the young women in. We convinced them to do it. That was obstacle number one. Number two was where the performance was actually where these men sleep. So, you know, we came in, we scouted the space. It was before me, but I could have made this mistake too. Not thinking about asking all of the questions of what this space does,
how do we respect the space that we're coming into? So we come in, and it's a pretty small space to begin with, and normally these guys come in at, you know, X hour, they put their mats down, they have their dinner, and they have to be out by 5 a.m. Like, this is how they stay warm in the winter. And we're coming in, we're doing a show in their space. So to navigate that was really difficult. And they were on mats, there were some chairs. So there was a lot of movement. The show happened. We probably had about 30 guys that actually watched the whole show. Another, like, you know, 30 or 50 or so in the canteen being really loud around it. But whenever there was fight scenes, that was a really successful thing. A couple of really great conversations came out of there. I met a veteran who was an awesome man, and I hope he's doing really well, and if the show really affects him. So there was some success within that show, but it's not a place that we're going to go back. We didn't ask the right questions going in to respect the space that we're going to. So that's really important. The second one that just didn't work for us, and we've come into this a couple of times, so we're still trying to figure out how to best communicate. Sometimes at senior living facilities, it's actually a nursing home. They're not calling you a nursing home, so you're going to get, like, people on cots and really just not cognitively there people. Or we've had, at this one particular show, there was a woman who was wheeled in and placed in the front row, and we learned later she's blind. So there's all these people talking, and it was actually a two-person show. And so she was going crazy. And so during the show, she was like, "Will you shut up?" I mean, she said this multiple times during the show, which is a little jarring for the, you know, but it wasn't, she shouldn't have been there. So there was also a communication breakdown on our end of, like, who's the most appropriate audience to come to this. So not every partnership works. So does anybody, we don't have very much time, does anybody have, like, a quick story on a partnership that did not work? Yeah?
I can just say, if it feels like an uphill battle, too, if you're convincing someone of the thing, they may just not be in a place. Maybe it is a perfect partnership at some point down the road, and I can see the potential in all kinds of things, and I am ridiculously impatient, so it can make it really hard for a partner. Like, I see where this could be, and if they're not there, it just don't bark up that tree. When it's mutually reciprocal, then it'll go. It'll catch fire a lot of times.
Totally. And the inverse, too. You can get a really excited, dedicated staff. But they want to see the show because they want to see the show. They're not necessarily thinking holistically about the community and what the whole community needs. So if you have the capacity to dive a little bit deeper and maybe connect with more than one staff or connect directly with the community or community members while you're there, that's beneficial too if it's possible.
Well, I think staff turnover happens a lot. And so for long-term partners, it's important to make sure that your contact is also managing up and managing around so that partnership isn't just living with that staff person, because when they leave, you need somebody else to know what's happening.
Again, with the tour, but with one of our partners, we take the tour too, we were doing classes, and we were doing a presentation of a play that was written by members from the community, and it's a homeless shelter, and we had, you know, some violent things happen in the middle of the class. And when those things happen, where's the partner? And we ended up deciding to pull out from doing programs inside of that shelter because they were overtaxed. They didn't have enough staff. Never mind. We have a great partner, and she's still there, but she wasn't the person who's going to be on the ground on the day of with that particular program. And, you know, we just walked in with no pants on one time. Yeah. You know, there's a lot of weird things that can happen, and so you then have to start thinking about the safety of, you know, whoever's working there that you're responsible for, and, you know, having that hard conversation with your partner, being like, hey, I don't know if this is the right time for you. I mean, it would be something really cool for your community and get the people interested, but you're not able to actually provide the staff to help identify those problems as they're coming in the door. So
retrospect, totally, I wish I would have started with this, and then we could talk about all the great things, but I didn't do it that way. So what I do want to end with is, even if a partnership is not the most successful and it doesn't continue, there's always somebody in that audience that you've touched. Mm-hmm. There just is. And you can't always see it. Sometimes you can look around at some of those excruciating shows and it's like, I hated it, completely non-responsive. But the thing that I love to look for at every show is you come in, and especially men's facilities. Men's facilities and women's facilities are very different. Often the women are a little bit warmer, ready to engage. But the men generally start out like this, in the back, each other, you know. And then by the end, they slowly start to come in. So what you're looking for in a partner is that lean in. You're looking for that lean in staff. You're looking for that lean in audience. You're looking for that person who